Welcome to our weekly comic book review. We will discuss 10 issues that we found interesting and would like to share with you. They are not numbers according from best to last, only in order of choice, but you need to stay to the end to know the list we put together. Hope you enjoy. Number 10, Aquaman Rebirth number 25. As Arthur Curry finds himself deposed, a new king rises in Atlantis, one named Stepan Sejcik. This single issue put Sejcik in the running to be the definitive Aquaman artist for years to come, and he comes aboard at a particularly strong moment in Dan Abnett's run with the character. Though it suffers slightly for its expository dialogue and some unexplained plot points, this issue gives life and depth to Atlantis and those who inhabit it. This is not an Aquaman number one in disguise, nor is it even really the start of a new story. Instead, this is a watershed moment in an ongoing story, but it's such a fascinating and breathtakingly beautiful one as to draw in new and old readers alike. Aquaman number 25 makes classic Aquaman feel new, expansive, and intelligent. Number 9, Luke Cage number 1. Luke Cage's new number 1 seeks to build a world around Marvel's first headlining African-American superhero and, in doing so, David Walker and co. follow all the rules for building up a character. The story is a classic return to basics that seeks to connect Cage with the process that made him. Detractors will rightfully say that there's not a lot that's new on display here, and that the art, nice as it is, fails to give a sense of an A-list revival for an overdue character seeing the peak of his popularity, but, at least in issue number 1, that doesn't seem to be the point of this one. This is a welcoming open to a series that is already brimming with heart and depth. Walker's distinctly noirish sensibility combines with Blake's wonderful storytelling and Luke Cage's clear and likable personality to provide a reading experience that not only has great fun with the tropes it invokes, but seems destined to stay relevant on bookstore shelves long after it fades from the new release's wall. This issue puts in the work, the down and dirty of storytelling. And, though it could benefit from a bigger hook for those who haven't yet realized the inherent appeal of Luke Cage, like its protagonist, this issue stands strong, primed for incredible possibilities. Number 8, Action Comics number 976. This issue neatly solves the problem of a universe that contained 2 Lois Lanes and 3 Clark Kents. But the matter-of-fact continuity shift raises a world of questions. If the timeline has shifted for Superman, it has shifted for everyone whose life touches Superman, meaning everybody in the known DC universe. If the Super Family has always been native to this timeline, the early background of Trinity, for instance, is erased. The ripples spread everywhere. Not to say this is a bad thing. Much of Rebirth has involved quietly, or at least pragmatically, rewriting continuity. See, for instance, Wonder Woman and Titans. It may be that John's action, like the punch on the wall of reality from a very different Superboy, will end up being the tool that opens many important doors. Number 7, Titans Annual number 1. The book's more subtle insight is the nature of teams in the DC universe. The Titans are friends, indeed family. In this, they resemble Batman's sprawling network or the tight-knit Kent clan more than the current iteration of the Justice League, who are a group of allies. The mysterious foe locked in a dimensional prison is probably only a side story to the greater epic of Rebirth. But for this side story, that difference may prove all important. Number 6, Batman Rebirth Annual number 18. After reading this issue, I had to just sit back for a moment, and soak in what I just read. During that moment, I tried to think of something catchy to write for this opening paragraph, and nothing quite felt right. All I can say is, this is by far the best issue of the Tom King and David Finch tenure. It was a very compelling and heartbreaking story, as you take a deep look into the lives of both, Bane and Batman. Their stories are so similar, and yet, so different. The core of their stories are essentially the same: a young boy orphaned by horrific circumstances, hell-bent on retribution, and trying desperately to regain what ripped from him. The only real difference between Batman and Bane is the environment. Obviously, Bruce Wayne, growing up a billionaire, had his entire life laid out before him. He also had a guiding light with a great moral compass in Alfred, to help steer his rage in the right direction. establishing an ethical value in his life for what's right and wrong, helping him make the right life decision to bring justice to the criminal underworld. Whereas Bane's landscape was completely different. He grew up in a prison, where the only thing he learned was, you either dominate and establish your power, or you're dominated and considered weak. It was survival of the fittest. There wasn't a guiding light, just rage. Not only for the loss of his mother, but a rage for the society above, that aimlessly stumble through life without worries. A rage for the ones who were able to have birthdays, holidays, and the simple pleasures in life that he never experienced. For his life was always filled with pain and loss. This was both an entertaining issue and emotionally gripping tale of two heartbroken kids set on making the world right from their own perspectives. It's an issue that excelled on all cylinders and is a must read. Number 5, The Ultimates to number 6. The Ultimates is quite simply one of the most stunning comics that Marvel has put out in a long while, and while there's an undeniable charm about its quiet way of telling some of the biggest stories in that multiverse, if you're not aware of it yet, you kind of need to be. This issue beautifully expands on the shocking reveal of last month and lovingly introduces a slew of wonderful weirdness that mixes modern sensibilities and unabashedly Silver Age creativity. Though the story as a whole takes precedence over some dialogue and individual moments, Ewing's narrative sense and Travel Forman's forceful layouts make the reading experience exactly that, an experience. With huge moments, incredible imagery, fantastic use of Marvel's multiverse, and the promise of even bigger and crazier things, The Ultimates to number 6 pulls this weird, wonderful series into sharp focus. This may be your best, last chance to jump onto one of the wildest rides in work-for-hire comics. Number 4, Thanos number 4. Life asked Death, "Why do people love me but hate you?" Death responded, "Because you are beautiful lie and I am a painful truth." Unknown author. In this issue we see a very familiar face, Thanos' one true love. The persons he's slaughtered entire planets to please. Death herself. However, she has a new plan entirely for her estranged lover. Death now wishes to entangle the mind of Thanos' son Thane, whose one mission in life is to overthrow his father, and to simply be regarded as a symbol of power. He wants to be feared like his father across the galaxy. Just as Thane was on the verge of a complete mental collapse, Death took advantage of the situation, offering a kind hand. Offering freedom and power. Something anyone would be susceptible to in that situation. Especially when that helping hand is offering you more than just a way out of prison, but something you long for even more. To kill Thanos. All in all, I thought this issue was well put together. It was great to see Death reintroduced into this story. Even though Thanos was nowhere to be found, he still held a critical role. Conveying the struggles of his only son Thane, as he plots the murder of his mad Titan father. Number 3, Spidey number 4. I love the idea of Spidey. The idea of a classic, easy to pick up, and truly all ages Spider-Man title is fantastic and, in my opinion, exactly what Marvel should be putting out. That said, the reality has not fully lived up to that lofty dream. It's not that Spidey has been bad, far from it, but it hasn't quite had the necessary spark. With Spidey number 4, Robbie Thompson follows in the footsteps of Amazing Spider-Man number 5 and pits our green Peter Parker against Doom himself. Thompson's version of Doom captures the intelligence, arrogance, and sophistication of the classic villain. Dr. Doom is probably a little beyond the wall crawler's abilities, whether now or in the past, but that only serves to make the adventure extra exciting. As ever, the biggest strength of this issue is Peter Parker. I fully admit that Thompson's script hits a little close to home for me, but that's not necessarily a bad thing, and I think that, especially considering the amount of space he has available to him, this issue presents an objectively strong way to build Peter's character for readers of this title. I would have loved to focus on the idea of Peter needing to take a day off a little more, but the story allows us a look at who Peter Parker is and, better than most, conveys that he's dealing with a lot, including a significant loss. Number 2, The New Avengers number 7. Fresh on the heels of the Hulkling and Demiurge story, New Avengers gives us the beginnings of a fascinating White Tiger epic while kindling an overdue interest in the Maker's plots. Al Ewing's love-hate relationship with Canon is, once again, to our benefit, as he pulls out all manner of clever tricks to turn the screws just a little further. Jay Gossar stops in to let us know that his talents are perfect for the White Tiger, delivering unsteady but forceful and beautiful lines that pair wonderfully with Rachel Rosenberg's colors. A welcome alternative for those who have complained of Gerardo Sandoval's style for this book. Unfortunately, for all the improvements this issue makes, the progress is uneven. Though the Maker and the White Tigers are the stars of the show, the rest of the writing is not Ewing's best. More pressingly, while there are a couple of real moments that reward the first reading, there's nothing extraordinary in the bigger picture. New Avengers number 7 is clever and fun, but its problems limited to being a merely enjoyable opening to a promising storyline. At number 1 is Superman Rebirth number 14. Of all the DC Rebirth books, Superman has been the most consistent with driving forward the underlying story of multi-universal mischief that underlies the initiative, followed by, interestingly enough, Titans. Whether or not this arc truly addresses the ultimate themes of Rebirth, it promises to reveal further truths about Superman and his nature, and presumably the nature of his family. And any story that resurrects the multiverse is worthy of initial interest. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, like and share to our channel on YouTube. See you next time.